Praise the Lord. We'll rise up as we pray together. Heavenly Father, we thank you for our Bible study. Thank you for bringing us here all the time so that you can impart your mind, your heart, your word, your will to every one of us. I will thank you, Lord, for the response of your people who are here for the Bible study today. We're asking, oh Lord, you speak to every heart in Jesus' name. I will pray, Lord, we'll not miss your word, your will for our lives. You'll direct us so that, Lord, we'll live the life pleasing unto you. And when that call will come to come up higher, none of us will be missing in Jesus' name. Well, thank you for a man like Stephen. You give him the courage, you give him the wisdom, you give him the word. And he declared the word at face value, without favor, without fear, without compromise. We pray, Lord, that same spirit of boldness, you grant every one of us in Jesus' name. Amen. That we will declare your word, we'll declare your will, we'll declare the way of salvation without any compromise in Jesus' name. Amen. We pray, Lord, if there are people here today who have not known you as the personal Savior, as Lord and Savior, we pray that as the word comes forth, you'll convict them of their sin and draw them near unto you in Jesus' name. Strengthen the believers tonight. Sanctify those who need to be sanctified. Made pure and holy in their hearts in Jesus' name. And for those who need your power, the power of the Holy Ghost, baptism in the Holy Ghost, immerse us in the Holy Ghost. Baptize us in the Holy Ghost. And we'll pray that your power will give us real spiritual backbone. We'll stand in the day of temptation and trial in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord, for the answer. In Jesus' name we pray. Once again, I welcome every one of you to our Bible study. It's always a wonderful time to share together and to study together in the Word of God. I need to make connection with the series we're looking at present. When the Acts of the Apostles chapter 7. But as you go back to chapter 6, you'll find there was a problem in the church. But thank God there was leadership in the church. And the leadership rose up immediately to solve that problem. The solution to the problem brought seven men of honest report, seven men full of the Holy Ghost, seven men full of divine wisdom, spiritual wisdom, scriptural wisdom, and seven men of honest report into the ministry of distributing necessities to the people of God. Among them we have Stephen, and then we have Philip. In this chapter 7, we come across Stephen, and we see him going beyond distributing food. When you come to chapter 8, we'll come to Philip, and then the rest of them, although they are not named personally or particularly, but they will be among the people that were scattered everywhere, preaching the word everywhere they went. But now, as we look at Stephen, we're coming back to chapter 6. In chapter 6, I'm reading from verse 8, it says, "And Stephen, full of faith and power, did great wonders and miracles among the people." We have learned already that Stephen branched out. He went forth and he manifested the power of God upon his life. But then in manifesting the power of God, this man being full of faith and full of power, doing miracles and working wonders among the people, he came across people he had to share the gospel with. In the sharing of the gospel, these were people committed to the law of Moses. These were people committed to the old traditional things. And this is Stephen boldly declared the word of God unto them. Then they kind of gathered men together, and they lied against him in persecuting him. Look at chapter 6 and verse 11. Then they summoned men, they hired men, and they got men together in conspiracy. And what did they say? Which said, "We have heard him speak blasphemous words against Moses and against God." And if you know anything about the children of Israel, although they were not born again, they zealously and vehemently and passionately defended the law of Moses. And when you said anything concerning Moses, they revered that man, they respected and loved that man. Although the man was not living in their generation, but then he said, looked at the past and he said, that was the lawgiver. That was the greatest man in the Old Testament that gave us what we stand on today. And of course, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, they loved him in their own way. Although they were not born again, they didn't accept Jesus Christ as their personal Savior, but they were mightily religious. Because of that, they said, this man has been speaking against Moses and against God. They went beyond that. Look at verse 13. And they set up false witnesses, which said, this man, referring to Stephen, ceases not to speak blasphemous words against this holy place and the law. Now, four things. Number one, this man, they said, was speaking against Moses. Number two, he was speaking against God. Number three, speaking against this place, the temple. And number four, speaking against the law. And that's the reason they dragged him before the jury, before the council, before the Sanhedrin, before the leaders of religion in the land. And those leaders of religion, they were interested. They pushed aside every other thing and they concentrated on this man, Stephen. But by the way, look at verse 15 of Acts chapter 6. It says, all that sat in the council, that is the council to which they brought him, because now they were going to judge him, and those who sat against him in judgment, it says, all the people that sat in the council, looking steadfastly on him, saw his face as it had been, tell me out loud, the face of an angel. Obviously, that man was not, you know, a person, a spineless man, a man without courage, a man without backbone. There was something within him, the Spirit of God. And then it shone forth on his face. And when he looked at his face, it was like the face of an angel. Then comes to chapter 7. Look at chapter 7, verse 1. Then said the high priest, are these things so? Now remember, all these people, they believed all these false prophets, false witnesses. And they said, he's spoken against God, he's spoken against Moses, he's spoken against this temple, he's spoken against the law. And the leaders wanted to know, they brought him to judgment, just like the judgment seat of those Jewish people. Are these things so? Before I go to chapter 7, I'm going to look at Matthew chapter 10. Matthew chapter 10, we're reading from verse 18. Matthew chapter 10, verse 18. And ye shall be brought before governors and kings for my sake, for a testimony against them and the Gentiles. And when they deliver you up, take no thought how or what ye shall speak, for it shall be given you in that same hour what ye shall speak. For it is not ye that speak, but the Spirit of your Father which speaketh in you. Remember, this man was full of the Holy Ghost, and the Lord Jesus Christ had given the promise. He said, this will happen. To be forewarned is to be forearmed. The Lord had warned them. He said, temptations will come, trials will come. You'll find the council of high priests and priests and those religious people, they'll gather together to judge you. And when they bring you, they're going to question you, are these things so? Is it right what we're hearing? Did you do that? Did you say that? Did you speak these blasphemous words against God, against Moses, against the law, and against this temple? And when they bring you like that, don't be afraid. And don't think about, what am I going to say? How am I going to respond to them? How will I answer them? He said, just make sure you are full of the Holy Ghost, and the Spirit of your Father will speak through you. And that is what we find in fulfillment in the life of Stephen. I pray that when it comes to your turn, that you have to stand up. You have to speak the word of God. You will not shake. You will not tremble. You will speak that word of God forcefully and faithfully and fearlessly, and the word of God will have impact on the people hearing from you in Jesus' name. Look at Luke chapter 21. Luke chapter 21, I'm reading here from verse 12. This is just to tell us that the Lord Jesus Christ prepared his own disciples. He said, this will happen. And now we're finding that in the case of Stephen, it actually happened. And the Lord supported him, and the Lord succored him, and the Lord assured him, and the Lord was staying by him, standing by him, dwelling within him mightily. And if God has not changed, and I know God has not changed, and if Jesus has not changed, I believe that Jesus has not changed. If the Holy Ghost has not changed, I believe he has not changed. He will be with you. He will stand by you. We don't need to shake or to tremble or to be fearful or to, you know, to be timid or to be fainting. When we're challenged about our faith, we should be ready to give an account of what we stand for and what we believe. And when that time comes, you will stand. In Luke chapter 21, I'm reading from verse 12. It says, but before all these, they shall lay their hands on you, and they shall persecute you, delivering you up to the synagogues and into the prisons, being brought before kings and rulers for my name's sake, and it shall turn to you for a testimony. I thought you'd say an amen there. It shall turn to you for a testimony. They'll come and it will be like they want to judge you. They want to condemn you. What all these false witnesses are saying about you, they want to hold on to those words and then knock you because of that. But the Lord said, no, his will be done in our lives. And then it says, it will turn to a testimony. Look at verse 14. Settle it therefore in your hearts, not to meditate before what he shall answer. For I will give you a mouth and wisdom which all your adversaries shall not be able to gainsay or resist. The Lord there gave a promise that he will give us the mouth, and then he'll give us the wisdom which all our enemies will not be able to gainsay, and he'll not be able to oppose intelligently. In this chapter 7, now we're back to Acts of the Apostles, chapter 7. The response and defense of Stephen is seen. And here the charges that were leveled against him, and he completely answered them. And he showed that he had a complete understanding, a clear understanding of the scriptures. And then he revealed something. Remember the four charges? Number one, speaking against Moses. Number two, speaking against God. Number three, speaking against this place, the temple. And number four, speaking against the Lord. And as you read chapter 7 of the Acts of the Apostles, you will find, number one, he had great honor and respect for the call and the character of Moses. In fact, he spoke about the commission, the consecration of Moses. He spoke about the consistency and the conviction and the courage of Moses. He said, are you accusing me that I'm opposed to Moses? Of course, no. I know about his call. I know about his character. I know about his commission. I know about his consecration. I know about his consistency. And I know about his conviction and courage. He also showed them with incisive boldness and clarity that the Jewish nation was guilty of rejecting Moses. He said, now you are defending Moses. Now you want to nail me because you think I'm against Moses. Didn't the people reject Moses when he came the first time? And so he was telling them that he was not the guilty one. They were the guilty people. Actually, the Bible says all the world has become guilty before God because all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. So you will not allow the sinners and your accusers and your adversaries and the people that do not know the scriptures to that kind of put your back to the wall and accuse you that you are guilty. By the grace of God, if you are born again, there's no condemnation to them that walk in the spirit. But it is the unbelievers that are guilty. It's the backsliders that are guilty. And then we'll speak the word of God to them and assure them that we know what we stand for, and they are the guilty ones, and we invite them to salvation, and they'll come to know the Lord in Jesus' name. Actually, when you think about Stephen, he proved to them that the nation with their leaders had always been guilty of refusing the man of God's choice. He said, you rejected Joseph, so you're rejecting Jesus. You rejected Moses, so you are rejecting Jesus. You rejected all the people that were sent to you for the first time. All those prophets, you rejected them. And isn't it the same way you are rejecting the Lord Jesus? Can I just show you from the scriptures that these people, they were full of rejection. Every time they rejected, they rejected, they rejected. In fact, it tells us, starting with Moses, he said, when he came for the first time, you said, who made you a ruler and a judge over us? That's how they rejected him. That's how Moses went away for the next 40 years. They couldn't see him again. And then when it came to the time of Samuel, look at 1 Samuel chapter 8 and verse 7. 1 Samuel chapter 8, and we're looking at verse 7 here. Here is what it's saying in verse 7. The Lord said unto Samuel, hearken unto the voice of the people in all that they say unto thee. For they have not rejected thee, but they have rejected me, that I should not reign over them. And so it was a nation of rejection. They were rejecting and rejecting. Look at Isaiah chapter 6. I'm reading from verse 9. Isaiah chapter 6, we're looking at verse 9. And so you will see that this nation accusing Stephen of rejecting Moses, they were the nation of rejectors. In Isaiah chapter 6, I'm reading here from verse 9. It says in verse 9, and he said, go and tell the people, hear ye indeed, but understand not, and see ye indeed, and perceive not, make the heart of these people fat, and make their ears heavy, and their eyes, and their eyes, lest they should see with their eyes, and hear with their ears, and understand with their heart, and be converted, and be healed. Then said I, Lord, how long? And he answered, until the cities be wasted without inhabitant, and the houses without man, and the land be utterly desolate. And the Lord have removed men far away, and there be a great forsaking in the midst of the land. And so Isaiah told them also, you are rejecting the Lord, you are rejecting the message that is sent unto you. We're looking at Jeremiah chapter 6. Jeremiah chapter 6. They had a bad history. It was a vicious cycle. That any leader that comes, that God sent to them, a prophet, he sent to them, a priest, he sent to them, a king, he sent to them, they will reject. And now the King of Kings came, and the Lord of Lords came, Jesus Christ, the Savior, the Lord, the Redeemer. Although they were in religion, yet they rejected the salvation that he brought. Are there not many people like that today? They say they go to church, they say they read the Bible, they say they believe in God. When you bring the real message to them, that except a man be born again, he cannot be saved, then they reject. And then when you show them that Jesus is the only way, there's no other name given among men whereby we must be saved, then they reject. But meanwhile, they're full of religion. Meanwhile, they're full of activities. Activities in religion, but they do not believe in the one that the Father had sent. Just like the children of Israel. And when it comes to fighting for tradition, they'll fight. When it comes to fighting for religion, they'll fight for religion. But the real thing, the essence of the Christian faith, being born again, that they reject. We're looking at Jeremiah chapter 6. And I'm reading here from verse 15. In Jeremiah chapter 6, verse 15, it says, what they ashamed when they had committed abomination? Say, nay, they were not at all ashamed, neither could they blush. There he goes on to say, therefore, they shall fall among them that fall. At the time that I visit them, they shall be cast down, says the Lord. Thus says the Lord, stand ye in the ways, and see, and ask for the old paths, and where is the good way, and walk the walk therein, and ye shall find rest unto your souls. The Lord was showing them how to have rest and renewal, how to have righteousness, and how to have relationship with him. But no, they wouldn't do that. Look at the latter part of verse 16. It says, but they said, we will not walk therein. They were the rejecters. It was they shouldn't have accused Stephen, because it was their own sin. Actually, they were seeing the reflection of their own life, and then they were imposing on Stephen the actuality of their lives. Look at verse 17. Also, I sent watchmen over you, saying, hearken to the sound of the trumpet. But they said, we will not hearken. And so it was with them that they rejected all the prophets that the Lord has sent unto them. Chapter 7 of Jeremiah. I'm reading from verse 23. Chapter 7, verse 23. It says, but this thing commanded I them, saying, obey my voice, and I will be your God, and ye shall be my people. Walk ye in all the ways that I have commanded you, that it may be well with you. It's only when we walk in the way of the Lord, we live according to the word of the Lord, we find the will of God and walk in the center of that will consistently. We walk in the center of that will without argument, without any questioning. We walk in the center of that will promptly and consistently in our lives. That's when we're going to be blessed. But look at the people in verse 24. It says, they hearkened not, nor inclined their ear, but they walked in the counsels and the imagination of their evil heart, and they went backward and not forward since the day that your fathers came forth out of the land of Egypt. Unto this day I have even sent unto you all my servants the prophets, daily rising up and sending them, and yet they will not listen. Look at verse 26. Yet they hearkened not unto me. Yet they hearkened not unto me. These are the people that are forcefully defending the name of God and the name of Moses and the temple, and they were defending the law, and yet they themselves, they will not even follow the word of God. Eventually Jesus Christ came, and Jesus began to reveal to them the mind of the Father, the way of salvation and the highway of holiness and the provision for sanctification. He began to tell them how they'll be right with God and walk in the center of the will of God. How did they respond? Look at John chapter 1 verses 10 and 11. John chapter 1 in verse 10. He was in the world, and the world was made by him, and the world knew him not. He came unto his own, and his own received him not. He came unto his own, and his own received him not. They couldn't get saved. Religious, but not saved. Very zealous for the law, but they were not saved. And they would defend Moses to the point of death, but they were not born again. And they would defend the name of God, the way they understood the name of God, even to the killing of another person, and yet they were not saved. Are there people like that today? They'll defend their church. They say their church is deeper life, and if you say anything against that deeper life church, they're ready to fight. They're ready to whatever they want to do, and yet they are not born again. There are people that will defend religion. They'll defend denomination. But to be born again and to forsake all their sins and then to live a life that is righteous and holy and pure in the sight of God, that they will not do. For such people, it's a pity. They might fight for religion eventually on the judgment day. If they die in that condition, they'll end up in hellfire. I pray that that will not be your lot in Jesus' name. And look at this in Matthew chapter 23. I'm reading from verse 37. Matthew chapter 23, verse 37. O Jerusalem, Jerusalem, thou that killest the prophets and stonest them that are sent unto thee. Jerusalem, at the very center, at the very seat of that temple, they stoned the prophets and the people that would declare to them the way of the Lord, the way of salvation, and the way of sanctification and holiness, and the way that will lead them to heaven, that narrow path that leads to heaven, that they rejected. And then you say, how often would I have gathered thy children together, even as a hen gathereth her chickens under her wings, and tell me the rest. Tell me out loud. Ye would not. You see the people, they say, we are the children of Abraham. And that's why they were defending the name of God, so to say, and the name of Moses, and then this holy place, as well as the law. Let us come now to the masterful defense of this great man of God, this Stephen, and see how he responded to them. And as he responded to them, we're looking at Stephen's masterful presentation of Christ, the Messiah, Stephen's masterful presentation of the Messiah. There are three things we're going to look at. Number one, inexcusable reaction to Moses, the mediator. That was their mediator, the one that came to show them the way of God, the plan of salvation, and the way to heaven, and the way they reconcile with God and live a life that is pleasing unto the Lord. Let's see how, what was their reaction to that, Moses. But it was an inexcusable reaction. Number two, irrefutable revelation of the Messiah through Moses. That Moses they were talking about, they said, we accept Moses, we love Moses, we revere Moses, we reverence Moses, but Moses spoke about the Messiah, and this Messiah they rejected. Irrefutable revelation of the Messiah through Moses. And then point number three, incessant rebellion against the mandate of the Most High. Incessant rebellion, always rebelling, always rebelling. Do you have the grace to obey? I pray that that will not be your lot in Jesus' name. Instead of instantly and all incessantly rebelling, you'll be incessantly righteous in Jesus' name. We're coming to point number one, inexcusable reaction to Moses the mediator. We're looking at it from chapter 7, Acts of the Apostles chapter 7. I'm reading from verse 17. It goes on to say, but when the time of the promise drew near, which God had sworn to Abraham, the people grew and multiplied in Egypt. You know their story already. If you're a student of the Bible, they came to the land of Egypt at the time when there was a great famine. And the great famine affected Egypt and affected Canaan. And Jacob and all the patriarchs were living in the land of Canaan. But then when they had, there was food in Egypt, and Joseph was there already. And Joseph had become the prime minister in Egypt. That's how eventually they came. The first time they didn't recognize Joseph and they went away. Then the second time they came again, and Joseph revealed himself to them. He said, is my father yet alive? That old man that you spoke of. And then how about Benjamin? And they all came eventually, and they were given the good part of the land. But eventually there was another Pharaoh that rose up that didn't know Joseph, and he began to deal with them in a subtle manner, wanting to kill their babies as soon as they were born. But they were multiplying all the same. Look at verse 18, till another king arose which knew not Joseph. The same dealt subtly with our kindred and even entreated our father, so that they cast out their young children to the end that they might not live. Then it goes to say, in which time Moses was born. Such a difficult time Moses was born. At such a time when death reigned in the land, Moses was born. At such a time when they didn't want any boy to remain alive, Moses was born, and was exceedingly feared and nourished up in his father's house 3 months. Remember the accusation? They said he was speaking blasphemous things against Moses. He said, me speaking against Moses? I know when Moses was born, he was exceedingly feared, and then he was nourished in his father's house 3 months. Look at this in verse 21. And when he was cast out, Pharaoh's daughter took him up and nourished him for her own son. He was showing them that he was more familiar with Moses than they were. You know, because he wasn't afraid, that's why he was able to tell them all about Moses. He knew the accusation. And isn't it wonderful that this man, he wasn't writing any notes down. Okay, they accused me, point number one. Number two, can you remind me, number three, what you're accusing me of? He didn't have to ask them at all. He remembered everything. And then number four, and then he took everything one by one by one, and without any preparation at all. You know, many of us today, if you have to, you know, say anything at all in a logical manner, you have to spend hours writing and developing the outline, introduction, point one, point two, point three, and then point number four, because of the four accusations that they leveled against him. But without even writing anything, he was looking at their faces, and their faces were kind of sparkling fire. And all the same, with all the fire there, he was showing them the word of God. I pray that that same kind of courage and the same kind of backbone the Lord will give to every one of us in Jesus' name, that you will never tremble before your adversary, You'll never tremble before your accusers. You know, some people, if you accuse them that this and this and this, everything they knew before would just evaporate. They wouldn't be able to say anything. But when you are born again and the spirit of your Father abides in you, he'll give you the words to say. At the right time, to the right people, in the right place, it will have the right effect in their hearts in Jesus' name. In verse 22, it says, and Moses was learned in all the wisdom of the Egyptians, and he was mighty in words and in deeds. Have you seen what Stephen is doing? He's recalling the life of Moses. And he said that man was a learned man, a respected man, a man that was chosen of God. And then he said he was full of wisdom. He was mighty in words and mighty in deeds. And when he was full 40 years old, it came into his heart to visit his brethren, the children of Israel, and seeing one of them suffer wrong, he defended him and avenged him that was oppressed and smote the Egyptian. And for he supposed his brethren would have understood how that God by his hand would deliver them, but they understood not. The ignorance has always been on your side. The ignorance is not on the side of the believers. We believers, we know the word of God. We stand on the word of God. We live by the word of God. We know what he has promised. We know what he has purposed. We know what he has prophesied. And we're living by that word. If there is anybody that does not understand, it's the people. People like you, that although you are defending Moses, you know nothing about Moses. Neither do you know the purpose for God, of God, for raising up Moses. But I know that. And then he began to tell them. He said, they didn't understand that Moses was raised up to be their leader. Look at verse 25. But for he supposed his brethren would have understood how that God by his son would deliver them, but they understood not. And the next day he showed himself unto them as they strove, and would have set them at one again. That is, uniting them and resolving the conflict in between them. Saying, sirs, ye are brethren, why do ye wrong one to another? But he that did his neighbor wrong, thrust him away, saying, who made thee a ruler and a judge over us? You see, that's how they rejected Moses. He said, you're rejecting Jesus is not, it's not surprising. That's what we've always done. Your fathers did that generation after generation. That is how the children of Israel have always rejected the truth. And they have rejected the men of truth. And they have rejected the ministers of truth. Well, let me bring it back to you. Are you one of those people that reject the truth? You read it in the Bible, you reject. You hear it in the message, you reject. And people come to witness to you that this is the way, walk ye therein. You reject. Although you are religious, you'll never miss going to church. You'll never miss this one, there and that one. I'm of the children of the stock of Abraham. I've been baptized in water. I was baptized and as an infant, I took the Lord's Supper, I take the communion. With all that you take, communion and Lord's Supper and everything, do you believe the word of God? Do you stand on the word of God? I never miss a Christmas time, I never miss Easter time, I never miss this and miss that, but do you believe the word of God? You see, these people, they were observing all those feasts and all those rituals and everything, but to stand on the word of God and be born again and live righteous lives, that was strange to them. And so we're told in verse 28, it says, will thou kill me as thou didest the Egyptian yesterday? They accused him. That's why in verse 29, then Moses fled as at their saying, and was a stranger in the land of Midian, where he begat two sons. And so you find the story of the children of Israel there. It was a story of rejection. Each generation pretends to receive the prophets rejected by the former generation. What I mean by that is that, you know, the people now, they love Moses now because Moses was gone. The people that lived at that time, when Moses was alive, they rejected him. The people that lived at the time of Samuel, they rejected him too. The people that lived in the time of Elijah, they rejected him. those who live in the time of Isaiah, they rejected it. But the present generation will say, we respect the prophets of God. That's the prophets of old. But the present prophet in their midst today, that one they will reject. That one they just commonize and say, what's he talking about? Salvation, righteousness, holiness, without which no man shall see the Lord. It's after that prophet is dead, that man of God is dead, then that generation that didn't know him face to face said, that was a great man, we love that man. But the people God sends to them, they will not accept. I pray that ours will be different. That when God sends his word to us, we'll accept that word, and then that word will change and transform our lives in Jesus' name. That's why Jesus told them that, oh, this is what we are saying, that if we had been in the days of our fathers, we would not have been partakers with them in the blood of the prophets. But the nation of Israel professed to receive and even reverence Moses, but when God first sent him, they refused and rejected. I've read that to you already from Acts of the Apostles chapter 7 verse 25. Moses understood his divine call and commission to be the deliverer and the redeemer of the nation. But the nation did not recognize and the divine appointment. And there's another thing we need to notice. Moses did not allow the rejection of the people to bring doubt in his heart. That's very important. You know, sometimes God has raised you up to be a pastor. He has raised you up to be an evangelist. He has raised you up to be a minister of the gospel. And the people that are closest to you and nearest to you, the people that should support you in that calling, they may not accept. They may just say, who are you? When did you grow up? We saw you here yesterday and last week you were here with us, and then you're rising up now. God has raised me up to be a preacher, to be a pastor, to be an evangelist, or to be a minister of the gospel. Even though they reject, you should be sure of the call of God upon your life. If the call of God is there, like the call of Moses, you'll know that you are going to stand by your call, and the Lord will stand by you in Jesus' name. Moses understood his divine call. He will not allow their rejection to confuse him. He knew that God had commissioned him to be the deliverer and the redeemer of the nation of Israel. Even though they didn't understand, he understood and he stood by the call. You stand by your call in Jesus' name. You know, sometimes you are witnessing, and then you go to your own relatives, you go to maybe your mother or your father, or you go to your senior brother or junior ones, and then you say, hear the word of the Lord. Say, hey, stop that. So you of all people, you say you're preaching. Who made you a preacher? Who made you a pastor? Come on now, don't say that. And then they want to say other things. They rubbish everything because you are their relatives. But you go to other people that do not know you, they respect that call. And the word of God will reach out to them in Jesus' name. That's why it says a prophet is not without honor except to those in his household. And so if your people do not accept you, don't pack it up and say, well, it means I'm not called. Of course you are called. I said you are called. And you are commissioned. And that call and commission will take effect and will bear fruit in Jesus' name. They were the people that were slow of heart to believe. The Jews in the days of Jesus and during the period of the early church, they also had that same spiritual blindness concerning Christ. And though Christ has showed many infallible proofs as a man approved of God among them, were by miracles and wonders and signs, yet they would none of this man. According to them, they said, this man will not reign over us. Paul the apostle tells us the reason why. Look at this in 2 Corinthians. Open your Bible, 2 Corinthians. I'm reading from chapter 3. In 2 Corinthians chapter 3, we're looking at verse 14 and verse 15. It says, but their minds were blinded. Nothing wrong with Moses. Nothing wrong with the prophet of God. Nothing wrong with the preacher of the gospel. It's the people hearing that reject, that have something wrong with them. It says, but their minds were blinded. For until this day remaineth the same veil untaken away in the reading of the Old Testament, which veil is done away in Christ. But even unto this day, when Moses is read, that is when the law of Moses is read, it says the veil is upon their hearts. And then it goes on to say, look at chapter 4, verse 4. Chapter 4, verse 4, it says, in whom the God of this world has blinded the minds of them which believe not. If you yield to unbelief, you're yielding your life to the devil, the God of this world. If you yield to doubting, and you say, I don't understand that, I doubt that, I don't think I want to receive that, you're yielding your life, you're turning your life over to the devil. And that devil can make somebody spiritually blind, that no matter what you hear, no matter what you see, you never really hear, you never really understand. It says it blinds the minds of them that believe not, in that verse 4, lest the light of the glorious gospel, who is the image of God, shall shine unto them. Then it says in verse 5, for we preach not ourselves, but Christ Jesus the Lord, and ourselves your servants for Jesus' sake. For God, who commanded the light to shine out of darkness, has shined in our hearts, and to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. And I pray that we will not miss this in our lives in Jesus' name. Concerning Moses, let's look at the commitment of Moses, the consecration of Moses, the commission that God gave Moses, and the consistency with which Moses carried that out. We're told in Hebrews chapter 11, I'm reading from verse 23, you will see here how Moses responded to the Lord. And I pray that we too will respond to the Lord like that in Jesus' name. We're looking at this in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 23. But by faith, Moses, when he was born, was hid 3 months of his parents, because they saw that he was a proper child. That's what Stephen was referring to. And then it says, and they were not afraid of the king's commandment. They were not afraid of the king's commandment that you should throw your children into the river, or somebody will come and throw them in the river. They knew that God had a purpose for Moses, just like God has a purpose for you. And he has a plan for you. And no matter the edict in the land wanting to kill all the people that are born, that is, kill them spiritually and kill them in any other way, that you will not be affected in Jesus' name. But you see, look at Moses now, verse 24. And by faith, Moses, when he was come to years, he refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter. He said, no, I'm not going to stay in the palace. I'm not going to stay in idolatry. I'm not going to stay with the evil practices of these Egyptians. I refuse everything, all their deities and all their luxury and all their treasures and everything. He rejected everything. If you have a call of God upon your life, all the things that will come to tempt you, to bribe you, to spoil you, you say, I reject, because you have something greater and higher than all that this world can offer. Look at verse 26. It says, to verse 25, it says, choosing rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season. He said, I choose hardship, I choose pain, I choose suffering, because he was looking at the glory beyond. You know, there are some people, they run away from pain, they run away from persecution, they run away from suffering, they run away from misunderstanding, they run away from every kind of pressure. Any little difficulty like this, you can't find me there, they're running away, they're looking for ease. But Moses said, I had a life to live, and because of that life I have to live, I choose rather to suffer affliction with the people of God. He made a right choice. You'll make a right choice. What pressure is there upon your life today? What difficulties do you have there in your life today, in your place of work? What difficulties, challenges do you have in your family right there? Because of your Christian faith, because of your conviction, are you going to become like, you know, a coward, you're an amphibian, there's no backbone, you're like jellyfish, well, the pressure is too much, I'm going to cave in, I'm going to yield? You will not cave in. You will not give up. And in the face of those challenges and difficulties, you will choose rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season. It says in verse 26, esteeming the reproach of Christ, that is all the insults, esteeming that, exalting that, all the insinuations and all the persecution, all the abusive language, everything. It says, esteeming the reproach of Christ greater riches than the treasures in Egypt, for he had respect unto the recompense of the reward. By faith he forsook Egypt, not fearing the wrath of the king, for he endured as seeing him who is invisible. How the Lord will impart such faith into every heart in Jesus' name. We're coming now to these people. We're coming back to them. Look at what they said in Acts of the Apostles chapter 7. Acts of the Apostles chapter 7. They didn't know who God had sent to them for their to be their deliverer. Neither did they know who God had sent to them to be their redeemer. And you know, see the kind of question they were asking. We're looking at it in verse 27. In verse 27, chapter 7, it says, "But he that did his neighbor wrong thrust him away, saying, who made thee a ruler and a judge over us?" Moses could have answered him, "Who made thee a ruler and a judge? God did. God called me. God commissioned me. And God commanded me that this is what I should do." Stephen's point is very clear. Former generation rejected the mediator sent from God. And the present generation also is rejecting the mediator. And you see, Jesus Christ is the mediator. Let's look at 1 Timothy chapter 2. 1 Timothy chapter 2. I'm reading from verses 5 and 6. 1 Timothy chapter 2. We're looking at verses 5 and 6. And they rejected Moses as their mediator. And this generation that Stephen was talking to, they also rejected Jesus Christ, their mediator. In 1 Timothy chapter 2, verses 5 and 6, "For there is one God and one mediator between God and man, the man Christ Jesus, who gave himself a ransom for all to be testified in due time." And so the Lord has given us this Jesus Christ. We will not reject in Jesus' name. They did not know the God who had sent him. But by the grace of God, we know who has sent the Lord Jesus Christ. Because the Father said, "This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased." I want to remind you that these nation of Israel, they were like a generation or many generations of rejectors. And let's see some of the scriptures. I was looking at 1 Samuel chapter 10. 1 Samuel chapter 10, I'm reading here from verse 19. And you will see the accusation of the scriptures against these children of Israel, that they rejected over and over. And I pray that you will not be among such a generation. In 1 Samuel chapter 10, I'm reading from verse 19. 1 Samuel chapter 10, we're looking at verse 19, and see what the Lord was saying about them. And ye have this day rejected your God, who himself saved you out of all your adversities and your tribulations, and ye have said unto him, "Nay, but set a king over us." They rejected God. As you look at a second, for Samuel chapter 15 verse 23. 1 Samuel chapter 15 verse 23. "Even the king they set over them, Saul, he also rejected God and rejected the word of God." What a pity for the children of Israel. The nation itself rejected God, and then they set a leader over them that rejected God. And you think about many people today, congregations today, that their pastors reject God. Their pastors reject the word of God. You think about groups of people today, they set a leader over them. That's our leader. That's a man. That's a woman. And this woman rejects God and rejects the word of God. I pray you'll not be under a leader that rejects God and his word in Jesus' name. Look at 1 Samuel chapter 15 verse 23. "For rebellion is as the sin of witchcraft, and stubbornness is as iniquity and idolatry. Because thou hast rejected the word of the Lord, he has also rejected thee from being king." You reject the word of the Lord, he'll reject you from being a minister, from being a pastor, from being a leader, and from being a preacher of the word of God. 2 Kings chapter 17. People that carry religion on the head, and yet, even though they forcefully and violently defend religion, they reject God and they reject the ways of God. So it is not just zeal. You know, people have zeal without knowledge. They don't believe the word of salvation. They don't believe in holiness. They don't believe sanctification. They don't believe baptism in the Holy Ghost. They don't believe all the salient, important, sacred teachings of the word of God. And yet they are very zealous about religion. I pray that will not be your case. In 2 Kings chapter 17, I'm reading here from verse 15. 2 Kings chapter 17, verse 15. And they rejected his statutes and his commandments and his covenant that he made with their fathers, and his testimonies which he testified against them, and they followed vanity. When you reject the word of the Lord, whatever else you are following, any psychology you are following is vanity, any philosophy you are following will be vanity. Once we reject God and we reject the word of God, whatever religion you are following in the sight of the Lord will be vanity. And they became vain and went after the heathen that were round about them, concerning whom the Lord had charged them that they should not do like them. But in the meantime, while these people rejected God and rejected the word of the Lord, do you know they were very religious? Look at verse 40. In verse 40, how be it, they did not hearken, but they did after their former manners. In verse 41, so these nations feared the Lord, They feared the Lord. They were religious. They will go to the temple. They feared the Lord. They will honor Moses and defend Moses. They feared the Lord. But look at what follows. And served their graven images, both their children and their children's children, as did their fathers, so do they unto this day. You see, that is the calamity and the tragedy and the damnation of religious people. Religious, they say they are, and they think, you know, they still have religion, but they don't have what it takes to really follow the Lord. Jeremiah, I'm reading chapter 8. In Jeremiah chapter 8, I'm reading verses 8 and 9. We want to avoid the situation whereby you are defending religion, you are fighting for religion, you're almost dying for religion, but then there's no salvation. But there's no acceptance of the totality of the will of God in your life. In Jeremiah chapter 8, verses 8 and 9, how do you say, we are wise and the Lord is with us? Lo, certainly in vain made he it. Then it says, the pen of the scribes is in vain. The wise men are ashamed. Then it says, they are dismayed and taken, and lo, they have rejected the word of the Lord, and what wisdom is in them? What wisdom is in them when they have rejected the word of the Lord? Hosea chapter 4. We're looking at Hosea chapter 4, and I'm reading here from verse 6. The important thing is for you to cleave to the Lord and hold on to the word of God and believe that word and lay by that word. Have it in your heart, have it in your soul, have it in your mind, and make it a way of life for yourself. It's not just, you know, I go to church, I'm religious, I'm a member of Deeper Life, and you're a member of Deeper Life, but how about salvation? How about being a new creature in Christ? How about walking in righteousness? How about walking in holiness according to the grace of God in our lives? That's what counts. That's what counts. And you see, these people, they rejected the word, but were very zealous. It tells us in Hosea chapter 4, and I'm reading here from verse 6. It says, my people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. Because thou hast rejected knowledge, I also will reject thee. Because thou hast rejected knowledge, I also will reject thee, that thou should not, will not be priest unto me. Seeing thou hast forgotten the law of thy God, I also will forget thy children. You know, they were also zealously evangelizing and making converts, and yet the Lord said, I'll reject your converts. I'll reject all those people you are bringing up because you have rejected the word of the Lord. Inexcusable reaction, that's what we have seen. We're coming to point number two now, irrefutable revelation of the Messiah through Moses. The irrefutable revelation of the Messiah through Moses. We're looking at Acts of the Apostles chapter 7. Acts of the Apostles chapter 7. I'm reading from verse 29. They fled Moses at this same, and was a stranger in the land of Midian, where he begat two sons. And when 40 years were expired, there appeared unto him in the wilderness out of Mount Sinai an angel of the Lord in a flame of fire in a bush. Here now he's talking about the burning bush. When God appeared unto Moses, look at this statement. See how he went from place to place to place in the scriptures. This person, they said, is against the law, speaking blasphemous things against the law and against the temple and against God and against Moses. I can't say any blasphemy here. Look at everything he said was reasonable. Everything he said was scriptural. Everything he said was logical. Everything he said was honoring to God. Everything he said was inviting them, come and believe the word of God. And these some believers, they could accuse a man like this, a man that was full of the Holy Ghost, a man that was honest, a man that was of good report, of honest report. They accused a man like this of blaspheming. These people were the sinners themselves, and thank God Stephen was a saint, and I pray that same saintly nature the Lord will give unto you in Jesus' name. And then he spoke about God appearing to him, and he said, verse 31, when Moses saw it, he wondered at the sight, and as he drew near to behold it, the voice of the Lord came unto him, saying, I am the God of thy fathers, the God of Abraham, and the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. Then Moses trembled and does not behold. Now it shows that he respected Moses. He honored Moses. He said, even Moses, he trembled when he heard the Lord himself speaking to him out of the burning bush. Then said the Lord unto him, put thou off thy shoes from thy feet, for the place where thou standest is holy ground. I have seen the affliction of my people which is in Egypt, and I have heard their groaning, and am come down to deliver them. And now come, I will send thee into Egypt. He said the call of Moses was very clear. It was God that said, I will send thee into Egypt. This Moses whom they refused, saying, who made thee a ruler and a judge, the same man, the same Moses that God sent unto them to be a ruler and a deliverer by the hand of the angel which appeared unto him. And he brought them out after that he had showed wonders and signs in the land of Egypt and in the Red Sea and in the wilderness 40 years. And so something should challenge you here, that this man Stephen, he was a man of the word, a man of the scriptures. See the way he lined up everything, and he didn't miss words at all. He didn't miss what he ought to say. He didn't put 3 before 1. He didn't put 20 before 10. He just went systematically. If you were, and they accused you like that, and they arrested you like that, and they accused you of speaking against the law, and speaking against Moses, and speaking against the temple, and speaking against God, and then he said, what do you say to all this? To start with, you will be so paralyzed with fear, paralyzed with intimidation, paralyzed with the look of the people as you see the fire on their faces, and they were ready to pounce on you. But this man was confident in the Lord, and I pray that same confidence and courage the Lord will give you in Jesus' name. And then he could recollect all the word of God and laid line upon line and precept upon precept. This man was a real believer in God, a real believer in the Lord Jesus Christ, a real believer in the Holy Ghost, and a real believer in the scriptures, the word of truth. And he spoke the word of truth unto them. All the references you have here, the references just are making allusion to everything that he had said. And this is all biblical history. Without any shadow of doubt, Moses was a towering figure in Israel, miraculously protected and preserved in childhood, appointed and approved by God, endowed with power to do signs and wonders, equipped and sent by God to be the nation's leader, the nation's deliverer, the nation's prophet, redeemer, and savior. We see his impact and influence throughout the divine revelation, from Exodus even to Revelation. As you look at the scriptures, almost every book of the Bible mentions Moses from the time of Exodus. He was set apart and sent by God. Yet Israel rejected him. Can you think about that? Somebody that you have his name in Exodus, his name in Leviticus, his name in Numbers, his name in Deuteronomy, his name is in Joshua, his name is in Judges, his name is in 1 Samuel, his name is in the Psalms, his name you find in the prophets, Isaiah, Jeremiah, everywhere. His name is in Matthew, even Jesus Christ mentioned his name. A person like that, so popular with heaven, Israel rejected him. And so don't be surprised if people reject you, if people say, who are you there? Who sent you? Even though the whole of heaven knows you, and the Holy Ghost knows you, and Jesus knows you, and God the Father knows you, and it bears witness in your heart that you are a real child of God, and yet all the other people reject you, do not let that surprise you. That's what they rejected Moses, but they same Moses, God honored him. I pray that the honor of God remain in your life in Jesus' name. It is the same Moses whom they refused, saying, who made thee a ruler and a judge, the same that God sent to be a ruler and a deliverer. The argument of the Jews who rejected Jesus is that if he had been sent by God as the Messiah, as the Savior, as the Lord, then they said the leaders of the nation would have recognized him. That's what they were saying. But Simeon said, do you think like that? How about Moses that they didn't recognize, even though God had sent him? By the way, it's only the leaders in the land of Israel at the time of Jesus that were blind. The common people knew that Jesus Christ was actually the prophet that had been prophesied before. Look at John chapter 6. John chapter 6, look at verse 14, and you will see what the common people said about the Lord Jesus. Only these religious people were blind. In John chapter 6, I'm looking at verse 14. Since then, those men, when they had seen the miracle that Jesus did, said, this is of a truth that prophet that shall come into the world. You see that? The common people knew that. They knew that this Jesus is the appointed one, is the anointed one, is the commissioned one, is the one that is sent to be our Savior, our Lord. Look at chapter 7 of John, verse 26. Chapter 7, verse 26. It tells us, but lo, he speaketh boldly, and they say nothing unto him. Do the rulers know indeed that this is the very Christ? The common people knew that. They said, don't the leaders know? Don't they have eyes to see and minds to understand? Can't they see the miracle this man is performing? Can't they see that nobody had done something like this in the land of Israel before? Do they know that this is the very Christ? Now, what do we say about these people that rejected the light, that rejected Jesus Christ, that rejected the truth against themselves? Well, the Bible tells us that the nation and the leaders were without excuse. Their rebellion and rejection would lead them to eternal destruction and damnation. Let us see the consequence of rejecting the light, rejecting the truth, rejecting the salvation, rejecting the Savior, rejecting the Lord. We're looking at Matthew chapter 23. Matthew chapter 23. I'm reading here from verse 33. Matthew chapter 23, verse 33. Ye serpents and ye generation of vipers, how can ye escape the damnation of hell? Their rejection led them to hell. Children of Abraham going to hell. Religious people going to hell. Those who said they were defending the law, defending Moses, defending God, defending the temple, going to hell. Because they rejected the word of salvation. Can you think of people, they never miss going to church, but they don't have salvation. And the damnation of hell is hanging on their head. I pray that will not be your lot. Look at Mark chapter 16. I'm reading from verse 16. Mark chapter 16, verse 16. Damnation for those who reject the gospel, who reject the salvation of the Lord. In Mark chapter 16, verse 16, it says, he that believeth and is baptized shall be saved, but he that believeth not shall be damned. He that believeth not, the one that is rejecting, I don't accept, I don't believe, I can't see that. My religion is enough. My self-righteousness is enough. I never miss church. I give money to the beggars. I do the best I can. They don't believe that Jesus Christ is the only Savior. It says, he that believeth not shall be damned. We're looking at Luke chapter 14. Luke chapter 14, the damnation of Christ's rejecters. The damnation of the rejecters of Christ. We're looking at at Luke chapter 14. I'm reading from chapter 13. Luke chapter 13. I'm reading from verse 24. It says, strive to enter in at the strait gate, for many, I say, will seek to enter in and shall not be able. When once the master of the house is risen up and has shut to the door, and ye begin to say without and to knock at the door, saying, Lord, Lord, open unto us, and he shall answer and say unto you, I know you not from whence ye are. And then shall ye begin to say, we have eaten and drunk in thy presence. What was the retreat? What was the conference? We ate there. You gave us free food, and you gave us free whatever, and thou, yet thou hast taught in our street. You even came to our area, you held crusade. But he shall say, I tell you, I know you not whence ye are. Depart from me, all ye that work iniquity. It's not enough to just attend a program and to eat there and to drink there and to hear the messages. We must give ear, give our mind, and give our heart to what we are hearing and be born again. Except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Follow peace with all men and holiness, without which no man shall see the Lord. We must go beyond just attending. We must have the word of God installed and inscribed in our hearts. It must change us. If any man be in Christ, it's a new creation, a new creature. All things are passed away, and behold, tell me the rest. All things have become new. They must see that your character has changed, your language has changed, your behavior has changed. Everything about you has changed because you came in contact with the Savior, with the Lord, with the Redeemer. You are not rejecting Christ or accepting Christ. Look at verse 28. There shall be weeping and gnashing of teeth when ye shall see Abraham and Isaac and Jacob and all the prophets in the kingdom of God, and ye yourself thrust out. I pray that you will not be damned on the final day. That this word of God we're hearing will lead us to real salvation and change of life in Jesus' name. In John chapter 3, I'm reading from verse 36. John chapter 3, verse 36. He that believeth on the Son has everlasting life. He that believeth not the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God abideth on him. He that believeth not. You see, all these people accusing Stephen, they didn't believe, and says the wrath of God shall be upon them. In John chapter 5, I'm reading from verse 27. He has given him authority, he has given Christ authority to execute judgment also, because he is the Son of Man. Marvel not at this, for the hour is coming in the which all that are in the grave shall hear his voice, and shall come forth, they that have done good unto the resurrection of life, and they that have done evil unto the resurrection of damnation. That's damnation on the final day for those who do not believe. Chapter 8 of John. John chapter 8, verse 24. John chapter 8, verse 24. It tells us in verse 24, I said therefore unto you that ye shall die in your sins, for if ye believe not that I am he, ye shall die in your sins. All these people that were defending the law and defending God and defending Moses, and they were defending this holy place, the temple, they didn't believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. And if they died in that condition, it will be damnation forever and ever. But today is the day of grace for you. Is the day of mercy for you. Believe. As you believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, you'll be saved. He'll come into your heart, he'll reign and rule in your heart, and then you will not be among the people that are just defending religion without having righteousness. We're coming to Acts of the Apostles chapter 7. Acts of the Apostles chapter 7. I'm reading from verse 38. From verse 38, it says, this is he that was in the church in the wilderness, in the congregation in the wilderness, in that assembly and fellowship in the wilderness with the angel which spake to him in Mount Sinai, and with our fathers, who received the lively oracles to give unto us, to whom our fathers would not obey. but thrust him from them. And in their hearts turned back again into Egypt, saying unto Aaron, make us gods to go before us. For as for this Moses, which brought us out of the land of Egypt, well, what not, what is become of him? He said, you can see this again when Moses said, this law you are talking about, when Moses went to the mountaintop to receive that law from the hand of the Lord, the people went back into idolatry before he even came back. And you are defending that law. In fact, when Moses came back, he broke the tables of law of the Lord, because they had broken it already in their lives. And then he goes on to say, In verse 41, and they made a calf in those days and offered sacrifice unto the idol and rejoiced in the works of their own hands. And then God turned and gave them up to worship the host of heaven, and as it is written in the book of the prophets, O ye house of Israel, have ye offered to me slain beasts and sacrifices by the space of 40 years in the wilderness? You see, he was telling them that even at that time, the people rejected the law, as you are rejecting also the Lord Jesus Christ today. But look at this in verse 42, then God turned and gave them up. God turned and gave them up. And Stephen was warning them, don't let that happen to you, because it can happen when you have, you know, when you are adamant in sin, you are rebellious in sin, and you're only holding religion, there's no righteousness. God gave them up. Look at Romans chapter 1, how God gives up people that are kind of rebellious, they're reprobates, they backslide, and they want to remain in their backsliding. They will not listen to the message of salvation and the message of restoration, the message of righteousness. They're satisfied with religion. God gave them up. I pray God will not give you up. When the word of God is warning you and is knocking at the door, open up, open your heart. I want to come in. I want to change your life. I want to transform you. I want your name in the book of life. Say, no, I reject. I don't want it now. I don't want to change now. Then eventually God gives them up. Look at Romans chapter 1 verse 24. Wherefore God also gave them up to uncleanness through the lust of their own hearts, to dishonor their own bodies between themselves. It says in verse 25, who changed the truth of God into a lie, and they worshipped and served the creature more than the Creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. For this cause God gave them up to vile affection. For even their women did change the natural use into that which is against nature. And likewise also men, leaving the natural use of the women, they bond in their lust one toward another. Men with men. You see, that's homosexuality. Men with men. You know, in the world in which we live today, God has given them up. No conscience anymore. And there's nothing to break, there's nothing to challenge them to say, this cannot be right. A woman marrying a woman, a man marrying a man, this cannot be right. They are totally dead in their consciences. And it says in that verse 27, men with men walking that which is unseemly, and receiving in themselves that recompense of their own error which was meet. And even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, for the third time, verse 28, God gave them over to a reprobate mind to do those things which are not convenient. And they say, I don't see anything wrong in that. And my conscience does not condemn me. I'm doing it and I'm all right. I feel good. I feel all right. I feel happy. Because God has given them up. And he will not even tell them anymore or convict them anymore. I pray you'll not come to that condition. In verse 29, being filled with all unrighteousness, fornication, wickedness, covetousness, maliciousness, full of envy, murder, debate, argument, and deceit, and malignity, and whisperers, backbiters, haters of God, despiteful, proud, boasters, inventors of evil things, disobedient to parents, without understanding, covenant breakers, and without natural affection, implacable, unmerciful, who knowing the judgment of God, that they which commit such things are worthy of death. Worthy of death. Not only do the same, but they have pleasure, they support, they sustain, they back the people that do them. And I pray that you will not be in their company in Jesus' name. You see the false witnesses addressing against Stephen, and vehemently they were saying, this man says not to speak blasphemous words against this holy place and against the law. And Stephen cleared himself of the charge referring to the law. He called it the living oracles. And eventually he went on and he told them their history. And he said that even concerning the temple, don't you know what God himself said? Look at chapter 7 of Acts of the Apostles, verse 49. Chapter 7, verse 49. He says, heaven is my throne, and the earth is my footstool. What house will ye build me, says the Lord? Or what is the place of my rest? Has not my hand made all these things? Eventually, he brought everything to a conclusion now. What conclusion did he bring? He says, instead of remaining feeling guilty and feeling condemned, you saw when all these people, you don't know their number. The numbers to their tent. Sanhedrin alone will be 71, and then with all the other accusers, it was a crowd. Everybody wanting to say that you are guilty, you are wrong, you're speaking against God, you're speaking against Moses, and you're speaking against the temple and against the law, and we caught you now, and we're going to deal with you. He turned around and he dealt with them spiritually. And by the grace of God, he brought the guilt and the condemnation upon them, and was still standing firm, and the Lord Jesus Christ supporting him. The Lord will support you. And the Spirit of God standing with him. The Spirit of God will stand with you in Jesus' name. He was bold. The righteous is as bold as a lion. That boldness of the righteous child of God, the Lord will grant unto you in Jesus' name. Look at the conclusion that he made with them in verse 51. Ye stiff-necked and uncircumcised in heart and ears, ye do always resist the Holy Ghost, as your fathers did, so do ye. Which of the prophets have not your fathers persecuted? And they have slain them which showed before of the coming of the just one, of whom ye have now been the betrayers and the murderers, who have received the law. You're talking about the law. You received the law by the disposition of angels and have not kept it. He charged them. If they had wanted to repent, this would be the time they should have repented. You see, when Jonah went to Nineveh, Jonah was not playing with the people, motivating the people. He was not patting them at the back. Yet 40 days and Nineveh shall be overthrown. And those people were not offended at the word of God. They were not religious. They were just sinners. They were pagans. They were heathens. They were idol worshippers. They were violent people. But when Jonah came and he declared the word of God says they repented. But look at these religious people. Instead of the word of God leading them to repentance, what happened to them is that they were just angry. I pray you will not be among the people that are angry at the word of God in Jesus' name. But you will have the right attitude. Look at Acts of the Apostles chapter 2. Acts of the Apostles chapter 2. I'm reading from verse 37. Now, when they heard this, they were pricked in their hearts. And they said to Peter and to the rest of the apostles, men and brethren, what shall we do? And Peter said unto them, repent. What shall we do? And Peter said unto them, repent. And look at verse 41. Then they that gladly received his word. It was a word that cut them to the heart, a word that pricked them in their hearts, a word that kind of pinched them in their hearts, a word that convicted them of their sin. And yet they gladly received it. They that gladly received the word were baptized, and the same day there were added unto them about 3,000 souls. And they didn't backslide, and they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship. We will continue. I said we will continue. Well, we've seen the life of Stephen today, and the defense that he brought for the gospel, and he stood firmly for the Lord. Your own time, when it comes, you will stand for the Lord in Jesus' name. Stand up for Jesus, you soldiers of the cross. Do not allow his banner to go down. Lift it high and let the people of the world know that Jesus is Savior, Jesus is Lord, and the Spirit of the Lord will give you the word to say at such a time of trial and temptation in Jesus' name. Let's rise up and talk to the Lord. Lord in prayer. If you have not believed on the Lord Jesus Christ, this is your chance. This is the moment of believing. And don't just remain there. Don't be hardened like these people that will read about in the Bible. That they say they were defending God and defending the law and defending Moses and defending the temple, defending religion, defending tradition, defending denomination, defending whatever. And yet they were not born again. Are you born again? Are you a child of God? Have you become a new creature in Christ? Is the Spirit of God bearing witness with your spirit, with your heart, that you are really, really, really a child of God? Are you righteous? Or are you despising the one that God has sent to you to bring the word of God to you? Are you one of those people that will jest, the people that will joke, the people that will ridicule, the people that will make fun, the people that will push them away? Who made you a ruler over us? Who made you a judge over us? Who made you my preacher? Who made you my pastor? Who made you my counselor? Why are you correcting me? Why are you pointing the word of God to me? Are you going to be among the people that reject the word of salvation, reject the truth of salvation? Are you rejecting salvation? It comes to you once again today. And the Lord is saying, come believing, come believing, come to Jesus. Look to Jesus and look and live. Many summers you have wasted. Many springs you've lost. Opportunities gone. You've been at conferences, you've been at retreats, you've been at revival sessions. You have the word of God. Are you jesting? Are you making fun? Are you just making religion the totality and the end point and the goal? I go to church, I go to retreat, and one of them, I'm deep alive. I was born here. There's nothing happening here that I don't know. And you'll defend the dressing, you'll defend not wearing jewelry, you'll defend this, but you are not born again. There's no holiness in your heart, no holiness on your tongue, no holiness in your principles, no holiness in your habit. Hypocrites. Even though you defend the law, you defend the temple, you defend the church, you defend this, you defend that, but you know who you are. The Lord is saying, today is the day of repentance. There is damnation if you die in sin. There's condemnation if you die in sin. There's hellfire if you die in sin. There's judgment if you die in sin. Don't be like these accusers and adversaries of Stephen, accusing him, and they were not right with God. They were carrying religion on their head, religion on their minds, religion on their back, religion on their dressing, religion, Sabbath day, no sanctification, Sabbath day, no salvation, Sabbath day, no holiness, no righteousness. Transparent holiness, consistent holiness, follow peace with all men and holiness without which no man shall see the Lord. Give your heart to the Lord Jesus today. He is your Savior. He says, behold, I stand at the door and knock. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hears my voice and opens the door, I will come into him and sup with him. He wants to come into you today. He wants to be your Savior. And whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Whosoever. Be a terrible sinner like Zacchaeus. Whosoever. Be a terrible sinner like that woman at the well. Whosoever. Be a terrible sinner like Saul of Tarsus. Whosoever. You be a terrible sinner. You can call upon the Lord today. Whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. The mercy of God is waiting for you. The love of God is drawing you, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. It's there. Whosoever will, let him come and take the water of life freely. Are you a believer? You have the courage of Stephen, the conviction of Stephen, the commitment of Stephen, The consecration of Stephen. The uncompromising backbone of Stephen. Can you stand? When temptation stares you in the face, can you stand? When accusers and adversaries of the gospel want to stand against you, will you stand? When they falsely accuse you and they said, we heard you speaking against the religion of the land. We heard you. You spoke against the sacred building of the state. When they accuse you, you spoke about the founder of their religion. Can you stand? Or will you compromise? Will you backslide? Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't mean that. I didn't say that. Can you stand for Christ? Can you stand for salvation? Can you stand for sound doctrine? Earnestly contending for the faith was delivered unto the saints. Earnestly defending the word was delivered unto the saints. Do you defend the word of salvation? Can you stand? Do you defend holiness and sanctification, purity of life and purity of heart? Can you stand? Do you defend the doctrines of the Bible? Can you stand? Sin was a man of honest report. Be of honest report. Sin was full of faith. Be full of faith. And Stephen was full of the Holy Ghost. Gracious man, heavenly minded man, obedient man, scriptural man, truthful man. That's what the Lord wants you to be. And remember, not just external holiness, inward, heart, transparent holiness. Without holiness, no man shall see the Lord.